what love is, and it just don't stop, but I explain it better when I can say what love's not. I know what love is, and it just don't stop, but I can explain it better when I say what love's not. I know what love is, and it just don't stop, but I explain it better when I can say what love's not. I know what love is, and it just don't stop, but I can explain it better. Love's not caught in mugshots and seen in drug spots. Love's not sex, so who they do next? Love's not road rage, porno pages in the eyes of a racist. Love's not whoring it. Love's not abortion. Of course, in love doesn't bomb clinics to make it finish. Love's not hating. Love's not a cynic. Love's not seen on Jerry Springer or expressed by middle finger. Love's really captured in the words of any singer. Love's not domestic violence saying shut up through the silence. Love's not represented in the wail of police sirens, abandoned children in abandoned buildings, random killings. Love's not slow to help you. Love is ready and willing. Love is patient and kind. Love is sight for the blind. Love is born before the warning. Love's transforming your mind. It's body and blood, bread and wine. Remember the time. Love is God divine, crucified for mankind. You want to know what love is? Just don't stop it. I explain it better when I can say what love's not. I know what love is, and it just don't stop it. I can explain it better when I say what love's not. I know what love is, and it just don't stop it. I explain it better when I can say what love's not. I know what love is, and it just don't stop, but we can explain it better when we say what love's not.
Come on forward, come on forward, come on forward. Where's all my lovers in the building? All those who's filled with the agape now, y'all got to get up on your feet. I need my youth to represent. Everybody on your feet for the King of Kings. Everybody on your feet for the Lord of Lords. Everybody on your feet for God Almighty. If he's done something for you, you're breathing in here this morning. Yes, he's done something for you. Yeah, you got vision this morning. He's done something for you. So I'm not asking you to praise God for me. I'm moving out the way. Let's direct this focus, this attention on our Lord and on our Savior, our Deliverer, our Refresher, Jesus Christ. God, we give you a thank you. We give you a hallelujah. We declare your worth on this morning, on this Youth Sunday, in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. Praise God. Y'all may be seated. Praise God. Man, it's good to be before you on this morning. I thank you, Pastors Charles and Azalea, for the opportunity to be before you. And on behalf of our youth, as I always like to do, let's just acknowledge our teens and young adults this morning by showing them some love. Right. Do I have any teens and young adults that can show love for yourself or for your neighbors? Y'all show some love for your, well, my youth and teen. Okay. All right. Good enough. Okay, so before I go any further, I just want to acknowledge our youth workers. If you guys can stand up, ladies and gents can stand up, those who help with our teens and young adults. Yeah, these are the ones that get your children, well, not your children, your teens in on Tuesday. Every other Tuesday, we get them in, and we pour into them. I mean, it is nothing sugar-coated. We don't pamper them. And as you can see, it is our teens. I hear myself. That's what's up. I'm going to let you go ahead and do your thing. No, I'm just kidding. So it's our teens that you see up here serving. They're first to serve. And that's what we want to pour into our teens and young adults, you know, so we don't want them coming in, taking up space in the chairs. We want them to be used by God. There is something that God has in them that we need. One thing I love about our teens and young adults, God didn't make a mistake when he decided to swag them out. He didn't make a mistake when he decided they wanted to have dreads and different color hair. And speaking of hair, none up here, but he didn't make a mistake when he made our youth. So let them be who they are. We're not going to try to say, hey, act like 47-year-old Anthony. No, I don't need you to be like me. Be you. God has a place for you in this church, in this service, in this world. And so we support y'all. So parents, if you have teens and you're looking for a place to plug them into, this is good ground right here. The Forward Christian Center is really good ground. We're growing our teens. We're loving on them, and we're growing them up to where we're not seeing any incidents. No teenage pregnancies up in here. No teens tripping on drugs. You know, they're going to be youth, and we understand things is going to happen, but this is a safety net where we can catch them. And the one thing I would say, man, if they can't run back to us, if they fall into anything, if they can't come talk to us, then we failed. We've done a bad job. We should be the first ones they want to come to when they mess up. We should be the first ones. They should want to call me at 12 o'clock in the morning if things is going bad. If they want to do otherwise, then yeah, we failed as a ministry. So, and I thank God that we actually have teens that will look us up and call us. So before we go any further, I'm going to follow my pastor's lead here. But this time I have an Android. So all my Android lovers, we're going to flip the script. If y'all have your Android devices, go ahead and take them out. And get your Androids out and follow us on social media, on Facebook, follow us, iPhones. Go ahead, get your iPhones out. I know. And follow us on social media, Forward Christian Center. Share the live feed because we are live right now and we want everybody to get this word on this morning. And then go ahead and break out your cameras and partner up with somebody. Take a group shot or something. Take a selfie this morning. And we are going to hashtag it perfect love. Perfect love. Y'all go ahead and do that. Make sure you're sharing the live feed. I'm going to come over here with this group of teens right here. We're going to snap it up real quick. I need y'all to get up in here with me. Come on now. Come on. All right. On three. One, two, three. All right. Thank you so much. Okay. If everybody has had the opportunity of doing that this morning, we if you've been with us, you know, in this month, we are talking about our five values. We've really been diving in deep into our five values, and you know, Pastor Charles and Pastor Isaiah, they've been talking about covenant connections, covenant collisions, and Pastor Azalea in our 9 o'clock coffee conversation, she's been taking us deeper into our five values, which is encouragement, support, good counsel, a sound word. And then on today, we're wrapping it up talking about love. I believe love is the glue to it all. I believe you can have the best talent. You can sing real good. You can do a lot of good things. And if you don't have love, man, it doesn't mean anything. So I believe love is the glue to this whole thing. And so we're going to talk more about that this morning, but I'm going to kind of come in a different way with you this morning. And to my teens and young adults, there's a lot I can identify with you. And I want you to have a listening ear on this morning. If you feel like you're getting sleepy or distracted, stand up. Just stand up because I need you to get this word on this morning. So let's go into the word this morning. And we're going to be coming from 1 John 4:18. 1 John 4:18. And this is a word that I would skip over. I would actually, I knew it was in the scripture, but I would skip over this particular scripture because I couldn't identify with anything being like this scripture is going to start off reading. So if everybody have your Bibles, let's all stand in reverence for the word of God this morning. How y'all feeling? How y'all doing? Everybody good? Youth Takeover, live in effect? All right. Okay, so 1 John 4:18, perfect love. There is no fear in love. Y'all say that. There is no fear in love. No fear in love, but perfect love drives out fear because fear has to do with punishment. The one who fears is not made perfect in love. Father God, in Jesus' name, I thank you for the word of God declared in 1 John 4:18. Let there be clarity, Father God, as we read through your word, as we acknowledge your love, that perfect love, God, the agape love. Let us understand it. May there be hearts, God, here. I know there's someone here that needs this word, and I thank you, God. It is an arrow, God. It is going to hit the spot on this morning. There will be deliverance on this morning. There's going to be a change of heart this morning, a change of thought. We're going to deal with the fears. We're going to bind them up. And I thank you, God, that you would be glorified. You would be exalted. Our teens on this morning, we're going to hear of a good report, God, because they have received this word on this morning. Let it land on good ground. I thank you that these things are done, and it is so. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. All right. Okay, so let's go ahead and dive on in. I want to also acknowledge my beautiful wife. She's somewhere around here. I think she's serving. She's serving Pastor Sky. Is she in the soundboard? Okay. All right, so Pastor Sky, I just want to acknowledge my wife. And, my wife is just, she is. Amazing, solid. I'm about to tear up here, man. But yeah, I thank God for my wife and all that she is to me in ministry. Man, we balance each other out like so well. We have a teen talk radio ministry that we're into. It's called Swerve Teen Talk Radio. And a lot of that, my wife was influential in the name, what it's about, and just tag teaming along with me, helping me through the vision, navigating through that. And she stands alongside me when I do these youth functions. And I just love the way she intentionally and on purpose pour into me and help, you know. And so, and the vision that she has, you know, acting, being an actress and everything. And y'all keep your eyes tuned to TV because she will be there. She will be there. Y'all believe that with me, she will be there. And so, yes, absolutely. So, all right, so perfect love this morning. So we're talking about perfect love. And I said this morning, I skipped over this because there was so much jacked up activity in my youth, in my lifestyle, that I didn't believe anything else could be perfect. Perfect what? Nothing can be perfect. So I reduced everything down, this perfect love of Christ, this agape love of Christ. I minimized that and associated that with every other failure in my life. Seeing my dad walk out, seeing mom tripping out, my brother, my big brother, you know, tripping out on me, failed relationships, anxiety, depression. I struggled with suicide. I had one suicide attempt in my life. Came face to face with death twice. And I'm looking at this perfect love. There is nothing perfect. Nothing has ever went right in my life. So how are you going to tell me that there is a perfect love that does anything? So I would cancel this scripture out and I would read right past this or not read it at all because I thought that there was nothing that could be perfect. And what I failed to understand that this perfect love is not talking about a thing, but who? It is a person. And so growing up and now me understanding that this perfect love, I can read it, God, Jesus, drives out all fear. This perfect love is a he. So I want you to understand that. So when you're in love with God, here's what happens. When you're in love with God, fear has to leave. And that's what we're going to deal with this morning, that fear. What is that fear that you may have? That fear has to do with that punishment. That punishment has to do with the fact that you can't enjoy life like you know you should be enjoying life. You just stay wrapped up, tied up in your mess, in your stuff, in your defeat, and you never ever seem to get out and really enjoy life. I remember on our Tuesday night Bible studies, pastors was telling us how to enjoy our Christian walk. You know, we need to enjoy this thing. We're so wrapped up in bondage, and you got Christians that's not even free. They save, but there's a punishment associated with their life because of that fear. The fear only exists because of the lack of perfect love. So perfect love, it cancels out fear. So where there is the presence of love, there is the absence of fear. You reverse that, where there's the presence of fear, there is no love. So the two can't coexist in the same space. One is always going to cancel out the other. So now you be the judge of your own life right here where you're sitting right now. How do you feel? What's going on in your life? The two are not existing in the same space. You are either entertaining fear and you're not walking in the complete call God has for you, and you know what that is, or you are excelling and you're soaring. And we can tell because we've talked about in our five values, we've talked about the ones that stick out like a sore thumb. If you're not operating in encouragement, you're sticking out. If you're not operating in support, you're sticking out. Not only in church, but even in your own home, at your job, with your friends, you're sticking out. If you're not operating in good counsel, you're sticking out. If you don't have a sound word in your life, guess what? That's right. If you're not operating in love, you are sticking out. And guess what we see? We see that fear. We see that punishment. We see a church where everybody is welcome to have all hands on deck. Get involved. But if we look around and we see that you're the only one that come in late, leave early, don't, you know, you're sticking out. And what we want you to do is deal with the fears. What is it? Are you antisocial? So am I. Look where I am. Just like our artist said, our guest said this morning, Jessica, I don't do this public speaking thing too well. I'm good being back there in the sound booth. I'm good. I can play the supporting role very, very well. I can do that well. But this is where God wants me to be. I had to deal with that fear because God has something in me that he wanted to get across to these youth. So to our teens, you think about some of the things that you have to deal with. Our young adults, What are some of the fears you have to deal with, even in school? Rejection from, now, I don't care too much about dating. I mean, everybody got their own, you know, rules and everything. The only reason that I don't suggest teen dating is I want you as a teen to get all you can as a teen without the distractions of anything else going on. Some can navigate through it really, really well, and others not so much. We don't want you falling into sexual sins or the temptations or the struggles when you got college to think about. You got military to think about. You got your life. There's so many more things to entertain and think about before anything else. I'm saying that to think about what are your fears right now as a teen. So when we begin to talk about this perfect love, there's a Greek word called, I'm going to mess it up, it's called teleios. And it literally means perfect. And so this scripture that we read in 1 John 4:18, it can actually say that the perfect love drives out all fear. Or the complete love, it drives out all fear. The there is nothing missing drives out all fear. The you can add to it and you can't take away from it drives out all fear. The it's self-sufficient and it's self-sustaining, yeah, it drives out all fear. It's not based on you, but based on Jesus' character and his performance that drives out all fear. It is the self-sufficient and self-sustaining that drives out all fear. It's called teleios, and it's a Greek word, and it literally means perfect. And so how do we respond to that perfect love? As a believer, how do you respond to that perfect love? Trying to wrap your brain around it, there is something that's self-sufficient, that it don't even involve me. You know how sometimes we have to, like, if I mess up with my wife or whatever, I'm going to go buy some roses and hope that when I come into the house, those roses is going to kind of speak for me, kind of paint a perfect picture. So you begin to do this performance thing. You begin to kind of do a song and a dance and prepare the speech because you know you messed up. Well, this love don't require none of that. See, this love is self-sufficient. Ain't nothing you got to bring to the table because the love is already there. All you got to do is show up and receive it and accept it. It doesn't need anything from you. It requires your participation in you believing and receiving. But a lot of times that perfect love is there. And what we do is we walk away from it. And then we find ourselves in fear. We find ourselves in disappointment. We find ourselves in loneliness. We find ourselves in anxiety and worry, suicidal attempts, depression, everything else. And guess what? We're saying, well, where is God? God never moved. Perfect love has never moved. So the way you get back to perfect love, you just get right back to it. Put one foot in front of the other and get back to perfect love. So we respond to it by this. God's love for us is not based on our ability to do anything. God's love for us is not based on our responsibility to do anything. You no longer need God's approval when you know you already got it. How many of you know that you already got God's approval? See, some people don't know that. Some people don't know that. I know that I already have God's approval on my life. I want you to get to that place to where you know that. You can't do enough things right. Wrap your brain around that. Again, we're in a society to where even when the teens mess up, you made a D or an F, or you was tardy in class and your mom and dad find out about it, you immediately begin to start to try to do a song and a dance. How can I correct this wrong? Because you want to get back into favor with your parents, right? Same thing with our spouses. We may have messed up some kind of way. We may have argued, tripped out something, and now we want to try to find a way. Well, with God, you can't do enough things right. All you have to do is receive his son, Jesus, accept that salvation freely given, and you show up to perfect love. You don't deserve it. That's why it's called love. Come on now. His love is free. It's not based on your ability to receive it, your ability to reciprocate it, your frailties, your mishaps, your past experiences, your past experiences, your past experiences. This love is not based on your past experiences. So why do I say that? Because our past experiences is that fear. It keeps us from showing up. It talks to us in the midnight hour sometimes. You wake up thinking about how dirty I was, how bad I was. Sometimes I would be in praise and worship, not now, but a few years ago, the worship would be so high. And this worship is calling us to a whole nother level. And yes, Lord, and I'm speaking in tongues. And then all of a sudden, the past failure say, but you know what you did 5, 10 years ago. You remember when you did this, that, and the third. And all of a sudden, my hands is doing just like this. And I'm like, you know what? You're right. And next thing you know, I'm sitting down. And the praise is going forward. This love has nothing to do with your past. Not a thing to do with your past. And it has nothing to do with your past comprehension of what you think love is. So we may think the past comprehension may be because when I was a kid, Dad walked out. We think that's what love is. Love walks out on people. When it ain't going my way, I get you first before you can get me. That's my past comprehension of what I think love is. And we grow up and we begin to mimic those things in our own families. So how do we demonstrate this love to those who are lost? How do we take this perfect love when we're receiving it? I've received this perfect love. I'm walking in it. I talk in it. I grow in it every single day. But how do I express this perfect love? Well, I'm going to tell on myself. I'm going to tell you what I did Friday night at the Petty D concert. Yeah, I hear my wife laughing because we talked about it. So Friday night, I was busy serving, working, walking around, right? Operating in perfect love. And I walked out to the foyer and I saw a Caucasian brother and two little children right out front. Now, what I've seen before was, I'm not going to say they were homeless. I'm not sure what they were, but I remember Pastor Charles would have, he may know them by name. They know Pastor Charles and they just kind of come here just to get prayer. I thought that's who they were, right? So I saw them, but in my mode of working, I'm just working. I see them, and then I go back to the back, still working, getting everything set up. And I come back, and I still see them, and they're looking to the church. And I walk out, and I say, can I help you, sir? He says, yeah, we're VIP. VIP? What? If y'all weren't a part of the concert, you don't know what I'm talking about. So they're VIP. And they're standing on the outside looking in, and I have formed this opinion that maybe they come here looking for a handout or something. No, they were VIP. So how do we respond to perfect love? How many VIPs have you rolled off in your life because what you think they're doing here? Nah, you never know. You never know who is standing in front of you. And I was looking at them, and my wife would tell you when I told her, man, my whole demeanor, attitude, tone, words change quickly. Come on in, sir. Come on in. Yeah, yeah. You know, come on back to the grapes and the hospitality room and everything else. But in that moment, I was like, God, please forgive me. Please forgive me. And it wasn't that I sat there and I wrote them off and was misjudging or anything. I just didn't move and I knew I felt the Holy Spirit telling me to go out no matter who they were. It doesn't matter who they were. I saw them. So I had a responsibility in that moment to respond. And perfect love was telling me, here's what you do. Because I don't know who they were. So anyway, so that was my experience this week, even being able to display what perfect love is to look like. So we have to respond to the hurt and the pain around us in love. If not, we give into that fear, and there is no reality to your faith. So you talk about this faith you have, but how do you know your faith is working? If you say you love God who you can't see, and you ain't loving on your brothers and your sisters, and the homeless, and you're not going out of city rescue mission, and you're not getting out with the Rose Outreach Ministry, but you say you love God, but you can't do that, there is no reality to your faith. None at all. You got to put that on display and let people see what that look like. And that fear, you have to respond to that fear. You have to deal with that fear. And the reason you have to is because that fear will keep you from serving God. If you want to embrace it, if you want to hang on to it for another 5 or 6 years, you're going to be in the same place entertaining that fear, and you would never grow in what God has for you. So I want to give you 7 significant fears that we deal with. But I'm going to do that by going through the story in Luke 15 and 11. This is the story of the prodigal son. And in studying this, I learned a lot more about the prodigal that I didn't really know before. One thing about the prodigal and reading, how many of you have heard the story or are kind of familiar with the prodigal son? And one of the things I thought about the prodigal, because of the way it was always read to me, or my own thought, was that it had more to do with the parent response to a runaway child. Has nothing to do with that. Prodigal doesn't even mean running away. That prodigal has to do with you having something good, and then you wasting it. You got good love. You got perfect love. Perfect love is right here. And then you waste it. You're reckless with it. Prodigal. The prodigal son. And it has more to do with the love of God, with how God receives us. So this story, it starts off in Luke 15. A certain man had two sons, and the younger of them said to his father, "Father, give me the portion of goods that falleth to me," and he divided them in his kingdom. I'm going to say something about this real quick. Him saying, "Father, give me my portion," was almost like him saying, "I don't need you. I'm better than you." In this culture, that's not what you say. Here, that's not what you do. So that's just like you telling Jesus, "I'm going to do my own thing. I don't need you. I understand your son died on the cross, but forget the blood. Forget all this other stuff. When you say, I'm going to do my own thing, when you say, I'm going to do what I want to do, give me, give me what I want," that's just like you saying, "Jesus, I don't need you." And this is what this prodigal son, this is what he was saying to his father. He said, "Father, give me my portion. Give me." And not many days after, the younger son gathered all together and took his journey into a far country, and there wasted his substance with riotous living. I need my teens to listen up, because there's going to come a place to where your mom and dad, they may get on your nerves. And you may think that you can get up and leave out the house, walk away, do what you want to do. Give me. I know I'm 15, 16, but I know more than you. I know I've only been on this earth for only 15 years, but I'm smarter than you. I got it all figured out. And yeah, mom and dad may be absolutely wrong. They could be wrong, but this has nothing to do with that. We're talking about you responding back to perfect love. There's a place for you as a teen and a young adult to where this gospel, you're wrapped up in this. This has your name on it. And I want you to see how you are included in the love of God and what he has to say about you. When you feel like, "I just got to run away. I'm tired. I'm hurting. Nobody understands me." I had one of our teens who was telling me how he had a tough time just talking to the opposite sex. Just talking. And some other struggles. And before we left out of there, he was crying in my arms like a baby. Crying hard. Because at this age, he's experienced that much pain. At this time in his life. Just from talking to somebody, y'all. Just to go up and say, "Hey, how you doing?" He experienced that much pain to where he wanted to check out of life. And so I wanted him to feel and know what perfect love felt like. It ain't wrapped up in a person, but it's wrapped up in Jesus. The perfect love is in Jesus. And I think we as parents, I think we miss pointing our teens back into the right direction. We miss it sometimes. Because then we start trying to do that song and dance, and we just mess it up and make it even worse. Sit down and tell them about Jesus. And so we had spent all of his earnings. There arose a mighty famine in that land. And he began to be in want. And he went and joined himself to a citizen of that country. And he sent him into his fields to feed the swine. Now, in this culture, when you got to the point to where swine and pigs was considered unclean anyway. But when you get to the point to where now you have to feed and eat what the swines eat, that's like the lowest of the low. So when you begin to say, "I want to leave my rightful place, when I want to leave love," you don't know what you're going to get into. Don't sit here and think that I got to figure it out. I'm going to go stay with my homeboy and my homegirl, and they're going to take me in because mom and dad tripping. Don't even go there. You don't know what you can get into. You don't know what addictions could come after you now, because you've left perfect love now. You've left that safety. You've left your covering. Notice in the text it said that he joined himself with another citizen. He joined himself with someone who didn't think like he was brought up to think, who didn't have the same beliefs that he was brought up to have. So now he joined in covenant the covenant collisions. He's joined in with some. So you're going to get everything else that that other person get because now you have joined in with them. And the best that he could offer him was to feed some pigs when that ain't even his culture. That ain't even what he should be doing. He was better than that. Teens and young adults, you just don't know. So it's best to just love it out. I was going to say tough it out, but love it out. Just stay there. Let God deal with mom and dad. Let God deal with them. And mom and dad, let God deal with the teens. He got them. He's making no mistakes. And so he would fain have filled his belly with the husk that the swine did eat. And no man gave unto him. And when he came to himself, he said, how many hired servants of my father's have bread enough to spare? So now he's going back thinking, man, I need to get back home. I need to get back home. It says he came to himself. It's literally like, wait a minute. Time out. Pineapples. Okay. I'm looking around. This ain't the best. And now he's thinking, I wonder if my father have food for me. How many hired servants of my father's have bread enough and to spare? And I perish with hunger. Then he says this. He get this clever idea. I'm going to rise up and go to my father, and I will say to my father, I have sinned against heaven and before thee, and I am no more worthy to be called thy son. Make me as one of thy hired servants. The song and the dance. You walked away from us, and now you're going to prepare this beautiful way to get back into the family by this song and this dance. And I'm going to come back, and I'm going to say, Dad, I was stupid. I messed up. The song and the dance. This is what we do when we try to respond back to perfect love. We want to bring God these excuses. Lord, I know I was dumb. I know. Here's what I love about this. He never had a chance to even say that. If you read through this, he never had the opportunity to do the song and the dance. That's what perfect love does. You want to go back to perfect love, and before you can begin to say, perfect love is going to do this. Perfect love is going to do this. And he arose and came to his father. But when he was yet a great way off, when he was yet far off, we've been far off in our attitude. We've been far off in our love walk. I was like there Friday night at the Petty D concert when they ain't represent the VIP standing out there. Yep, I was a far off. We've all been a far off. But this word says here that when he was a far off, it says, the father saw him, had compassion, and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. Nowhere in here does it say that the son had an opportunity to say, Dad, I did this and did that. The father immediately saw him. That lets me know something. The father was looking for you. Y'all get that? The father got eyes for you. He got eyes for his children. He was looking for you this whole time. So while he was afar off, the father saw him already. And then he began to do something that was also uncommon for men back in their culture. He had his tunic on. He had to pull his tunic up so he wouldn't trip on it. And he began to throw them legs out and began to run. Men were not supposed to do that back in that day. You're not supposed to run. This father did everything outside of culture. Perfect love does everything outside of culture. Perfect love does everything outside of the norm. Perfect love would say, my wife tripping, I'm mad. And perfect love would say, go cook her some dinner. Perfect love is going to say, go rub her back. Perfect love is going to say, you know what, babe? I'm sorry. Amen. You see why I married her? That's my help. Perfect love is going to have you doing what's not normal. Perfect love have you doing what's not familiar. Perfect love operates outside of culture. What I love about this, the story talks about how the father gave the son some shoes, some sandals, because the father said, I want you to be around here for a while. I want you to stick around. I'm going to give you some shoes. Perfect love wants you to stick around, wants you to be around, wants you to relax. So I zoned in on this part where the father came to his son and it said he fell on his neck. And that's something you don't see nowadays. And he began to kiss him. Now, one thing, I've seen this when I was in the United States Navy. I've seen this in that culture. When they kiss them, When they kiss them, they don't just, hey, welcome back. There are many kisses. The one thing about them, they are some kissing folk. And he kissed them. And the Holy Spirit began to show me how he gave him seven kisses. Seven kisses. Those seven kisses, what the Holy Spirit was showing me was the fears that we have to deal with. Those seven fears. I'm going to go over this with you real quick. There was a kiss that he gave him that represented the kiss of forgiveness. That kiss delivers you from guilt. Perfect love is kissing you on this morning. Respond to that kiss. If you're in here and you're feeling guilty about anything, God has already seen you. He's responding to you. And he's falling on you, kissing you with that kiss that gets rid of that guilt. The second kiss was the fear of being judged, condemned, or our sin being remembered. So that kiss said, not anymore. I need you to know that I forgive you. We don't have to even rehearse this anymore. You don't even have to remain there anymore. We don't could even talk about it. That song and dance you wanted to do, the words you wanted to write, you ain't even got to say it. Don't even worry about it. Rip up your letter. Get rid of it. We now could even talk about it. The third one, the privilege has been restored. Privilege has been restored. Remember, he went and he took citizenship with somebody else where he had to feed pigs. His citizenship, the privileges has been restored. If I say that to you, your privileges have been restored, you're coming out of punishment. Teens, Josiah. If your mom comes to you and say your privileges have been restored, what does that mean to you? You get your phone back. Little brother over here. If you're on punishment, yes, you, looking around, yeah, okay. If you're on punishment and your parent says your privileges are restored, what does that mean to you? You get to game again. Come on. So on a large scale, can I ask any adult? Pastor Sam. If Pastor Robbins, I'm just kidding. If Pastor Robbins say your privileges are restored. Let me get some water. Let me get out of this. Hold on, wait a minute. Hold on, wait a minute. I know what that means for me. My privileges have been, I'm married, so my privileges have been restored. So that's what that kiss represented, that your privileges are restored. You're my son. You're not a slave. You're not a servant. I accept you, and everything that is lost is restored. The years, the time, the opportunity, the lack, losing, all is restored. Amen. The blessings. When you kiss your children, it's breathing and releasing the blessing into the life, and it delivers them from lack and from the curse. And I made sure I did that to my son every time. I embarrassed him as many times as I could until, you know, I got to a point where I stopped. But I would kiss my son because I wanted him to know, son, you got my blessings. You have my permission. I support everything about you. And I still give him somewhat of a spiritual kiss now. I send him a text as often as I can, and I tell him, son, I'm your biggest fan. A kiss. A kiss of a blessing. Fathers, give your sons a kiss. If it's not a physical, literal kiss, kiss your children. Teens, how can you kiss your parents? What can you do to kiss your parents? You have to think about it. Yeah. Who said it? Go to school, be respectful, yes ma'am, no ma'am. You're giving your parents that kiss. That blessing, you're acknowledging the fact that I recognize that you are my mom and my dad. Thank you for that. Be thankful. Say thank you. If they give you something, say thankful. And then take care of it. Don't have it broken like the next day. No. In the next 5 minutes. No. In the next minute. No. In the next second. Don't have it broken. Take care of it, man. Kiss your parents back. Okay. And then number five, the kiss of comfort. It casts out loneliness, being an outcast, being left out, being rejected. That was my thing. Rejection. But thank God that there was a kiss of comfort. And there's people in here this morning that needs that comfort. There's somebody in here that needs to know that I'm not an outcast. I know I don't act like everybody else. I may not fit in with everybody else. But God has already gave me that kiss of comfort. So I'm good. So when I was growing up as a teen, I tried to fit in with every clique that I could. I could rap good. I could beatbox back in the day. I could dance a little bit. And I thought if I could just do that, then I could be included in every clique and in every group. Every clique and in every group I tried to get in picked at me. They bullied me. They talked about me. And so that made me try to do something else even worse that I don't even normally do. I tried to smoke one time. I tried to do crazy stuff that Anthony just don't do. Later on, I realized that it's not that I couldn't fit in. God was holding me back. So perhaps if you're trying to fit in with a clique and it's not going so smoothly, it ain't them. It ain't you. It's perfect love. Perfect love is holding you back. Perfect love has his arm like this saying, nope, you can't go here because I got something for you. You don't understand it right now, but hold up, son. Hold up, baby girl. I got something for you, something that's better. I know all your boys is looking at pornography. I know all of them talk about this, that, and the third. They want to go to the club, sneak out, and do this, that, and the third. You don't do that because I got something else that's better for you. Perfect love. Perfect love is going to give you that kiss of comfort to make you not feel like you're an outcast, like you're wasting your life away. And then the kiss of reassurance that this is real. This right here. I'm going to try to go up another octave. This right here. This is real. And that's what we're looking for. We're looking for something that's real. And there is a kiss of reassurance that says this is real. Confirming God's goodness will last. I remember hearing Pastor Charles say this morning that love that says, you know, me love you for a long time. Well, that long time has an expiration. It expires. And, you know, it could expire the minute you have conflict. Oh, there go that love. You don't know. But this right here is the kiss of reassurance that lets you know that this love will never run out. And then the fear of disapproval that we face, the fear of disapproval. Even though others don't approve of me or approve of you, this kiss says that my Father approves of me. I'm Gucci. I'm good. As long as I know my dad got me, I'm good. And even naturally, although I never got approval from my natural dad, never did, I can only imagine if my dad had done that, how much better things would be. Now, there was other men that God placed in my life where they would just pour this type of kiss into me, this of disapproval. And man, it just makes you feel so good about life. Give your family that kiss. And most importantly, realize that God, perfect love, is giving you that kiss this morning. If you feel like you are not approval material to anybody, cool. Don't even try to prove it. Perfect love already got you. It's already done. So I'm going to go back to the story of the prodigal son. So that was the seven. Now, the part two of the prodigal son that we don't normally hear about, this brother. Let's go back to the brother. There was two sons, remember? There was two. So this other brother, the older brother, he became angry. And he refused to go back in to celebrate the return of the prodigal. The brothers come back home. So his father went out and pleaded with him. But he answered to his father, look, man, all these years, y'all get this because this is true. This is how we do. We got me, Anthony. I've been serving here 3-4 years. I'm serving in ministry. And then this sinner comes in off the street. He comes in, gets saved, and right away, Pastor Charles and Isaiah take to him, and they go into the house and eating, and they taking selfies on Facebook, blah, 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 and Pastor Charles is saying, Pastor Anthony, I need you to participate. Come here, celebrate with us. And I'm like, look here, pastors. I done been here 3-4 years doing, I ain't never been to your house. We ain't, that kind of attitude. This is what their brother had. Now, I wouldn't dare do that to my pastors. I don't even got to go eat with them. I know they love me. I feel they love. I support them. Anyway, his father went out and pleaded with him. But he answered to his father, look, all these years I've been slaving for you and never disobeyed your orders. You see the word slaving? Yeah, he was being extra. Slaving for you and never disobeyed your orders. Yet you never gave me even a young goat so I could celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours, not my brother, not Johnny, this son of yours, mm, When he came, he squandered your property with prostitutes. When he comes home, you kill the fatted calf for him. My son, the father said, you are always with me. Man, please get that. Perfect love is standing here having a conversation with you. Perfect love is telling you, my son, you've always been with me. And everything I have is yours. But we had to celebrate and be glad because this brother of yours was dead and is alive again. He was lost and now he is found. So here's what I thought about with the two sons. Both of them had the same opportunity of perfect love. Both of them had access to perfect love. But for the one that walked away and came back to it, this was brand new to him. The ones that always have the things, they don't appreciate it as much. They begin to squander it. They don't care about it. They don't see it. And that brother should have been in celebration with the lost. I'm saying that to you all right now. Again, how can you say you love God who you don't see, and you got all this opportunity around you to put your faith on display? So when those that's lost come in, or you know somebody out there who needs this perfect love and you're not giving it to them, yeah, you acting just like this older brother. And you're almost calling them other people, this son of yours. Nah, they got a name. Get to know them. They begin to see perfect love through you. They get to see this display of perfect love through you. So some of the things that we struggle against with the fears, and I think I have a list of some of the fears that we may all struggle with. Loneliness. And as I read this stuff off, check your spirit, check yourself. If these are your struggles, if these are your fears, these are the things that's keeping you from getting into perfect love. These are the things that's between you and you just reaching perfect love. Loneliness, depression, lack. I have a fear of not having enough. I have a fear of not being good enough. A fear of death. I have a fear of rejection. A fear of rejection. Commitment. I have a fear of the unknown. I have a fear of being disappointed. Yeah. A fear of pain. A fear of failure. A fear of success. A fear of sickness. And that fear of appearance. So y'all just think about this list right here. And you determine in your own heart, what's keeping me from getting into this perfect love? What song and dance am I always trying to present before God so that I can get back into perfect love? Be reminded again, it ain't got nothing to do with you. God has already done the finished work. It is already finished. The only thing you have to do is deal with that fear that's keeping you into punishment. And God is saying to you, you're already free. So respond back to that punishment. One more thing I want to share with you, and then we're going to have a presentation about our dance ministry. This prodigal again. Here's some facts that I think we kind of missed about this whole story of the prodigal son. The prodigal son decided to head home, thinking that maybe his father would receive him as a servant. This is proof that the son didn't understand the depth of his father's love and compassion. Think about that. So you think you're only good enough to come in and just be the lowly of the low. I'm just going to be out of sight, out of mind. I just want to hide. And that's where you fail to realize the compassion of God's love. The prodigal son, I said this before, he rehearsed that speech, but he never got a chance to use it. I encourage you again today. The excuses, get them out of your mouth. The discouragement stuff, get them out of your mouth. Stop rehearsing that past stuff. You will never have a chance to use it anyway because perfect love is coming after you. When the father sees his son, he runs and greets him. And as I said before, this is a taboo thing. Perfect love does things that is out of the norm. It does things that is out of the norm. If a Jewish son squandered his money, giving it over to the Gentiles, he would have been cut off from the community upon his return. The father likely ran to meet his son to reach him before anyone else in the community had a chance to confront him. And the fact that the father runs to receive him is scandalous and shocking, and it goes against the cultural norm. So before anybody else can get to you and tell you how bad and dirty and stinking and nasty you are, Perfect love is going to intercept it every single time and get to you before anybody else can get to you and tell you what you are not. Perfect love has already settled it. Reminds me of something the Dallas Cowboys would do. I'm listening for my wife again. And lastly, I just want to say this before our dance ministry come up. The oldest son represented the Pharisees and the scribes. They felt disrespected by God's scandalous grace to the sinner and the outcast. Besides, they've been keeping the rules since day one. So why didn't I get a party? The thing about this, the older son, and I haven't really studied this out, so if there is something, I would ask you to help me out with this. After the older son chose not to participate, we hear nothing else about him again. He just disappears. So that says that in the natural and in the spirit, let's say you don't want to respond to perfect love. Let's say you don't want to celebrate with the loss that's coming in. You are behaving exactly like this oldest son. You can write yourself right out of the will. Something about a will, an inheritance, and I said this before, something about an inheritance, if you're written in the will, it's yours. What do you have to do to get your inheritance? What do you have to do to get your inheritance? What do you have to do to get your inheritance? Nothing. All you got to do is show up to get it. But why are there some of us that don't even show up to get what perfect love have to offer us? So don't be like the oldest son and just get completely written out of the story. What else does God have for you? Won't you stay still enough and show up to see what God has for you? What perfect love has for you? This loneliness, this doubt, this anxiety, that's not who you are. If you're dealing with it on today, don't walk out of here still dealing with that stuff. Perfect love has come running to you, kissing you on the neck, loving on you, and telling you that I'm comforting you, I got you. You're Gucci. You're good. Why don't you respond to this perfect love on today in the name of Jesus? Our praise team, our dance team, they have a presentation for you, and we'll be back with the close. Thank you.
Amen, amen, amen. Let us stand up on our feet for this service right now.
Thanks for tuning in. And be sure to join us for our weekly services, starting on Sundays at 9 a.m. for coffee and conversation, and then 10 a.m. for our Sunday morning service, followed on Tuesdays at 7 p.m. for our Student of the Word interactive Bible study. On behalf of Pastor Charles and Pastor Zelia, we pray you have an amazing week. And we want you to remember, there's only one way to go in God, and that's forward.